Hey guys, welcome back to my channel, The ENT Resident. Today I'll be doing a discussion on radical mastoidectomy. What is radical mastoidectomy? What are the aims of the surgery? What are its indications, contraindications? What are the steps of surgery? And what is the post-operative care required for this? You can also now purchase my notes. I have added links in the description. Okay, so let's get started. So in our previous class, I have discussed about modified radical mastoidectomy. Radical mastoidectomy is actually very similar to it, but it has a few additional steps over here. So what is radical mastoidectomy? So this is an operation. This is basically a canal wall down procedure. We have discussed in a previous video the differences between canal wall down and canal wall up procedure. So in canal wall down, we remove the posterior meatal wall and convert the mastoid cavity and external auditory canal into a single cavity. So in our last class in modified radical mastoidectomy, which is also a canal wall down procedure, but it is a more conservative surgery where we try to retain the hearing mechanism as much as possible and reconstruct the hearing mechanism. But radical mastoidectomy is a more radical surgery where the ear becomes non-functional at the end of it. So this is an operation where we are trying to eradicate disease of the middle ear and mastoid, in which the mastoid, middle ear, attic and antrum, they are all exteriorized into the external auditory canal by removal of the posterior meatal wall. So this, in the image, you can see that there is no posterior meatal wall left over here, and the whole thing is converted into one single cavity. Along with this, it is important to remember what differentiates it from MRM is that it all the remnants of the tympanic membrane, the ossicles, which includes malleus and incus, but not stapes. Stapes is not removed over here. At least the stapes foot plate is preserved in a case of radical mastoidectomy. And other than that, the caudate tympani and the mucoperiosteal lining, these are all removed. And also the opening of the eustachian tube, you can see that this is a eustachian tube opening. This is also obliterated by packing it with a piece of muscle or a cartilage into it. So at the end of radical mastoidectomy, we do not have a functional ear anymore, but we have removed all of the disease over here. So that's what radical mastoidectomy is. It is a canal wall down procedure. So now coming to the aims of radical mastoidectomy, our first aim over here is to eradicate all the disease from mastoid and middle ear and then create a large exteriorized cavity which is safe and is self-cleansing. But important part to remember here is that functional hearing is not preserved in these cases and we do not try to reconstruct the hearing mechanism of the ear. These are our aims for radical mastoidectomy. Next, let's talk about what are the indications of radical mastoidectomy. So our first indication is an unresectable cholesteatoma. When the cholesteatoma invades the eustachian tube or the round window niche or perilabyrinthine cells or the petrous apex, these are all cases which are difficult to resect out while preserving all of the structures. So in these cases, we perform a radical mastoidectomy. Second is if it is a non-serviceable hearing ear with squamosal disease. So if the disease, if the ear is already non-serviceable, then we can perform a radical mastoidectomy if they have presented to you with a squamosal disease. Third indication is an intractable or a recurrent disease, which is not controlled by MRM or any other canal wall up procedures. In these cases, we'll go for a radical mastoidectomy. Other than this, malignancies like removal of glomus tumor or malignancy of middle ear are also indications for radical mastoidectomy. And lastly, this can also be used as an approach to the petrous apex. So these are our six indications for performing a radical mastoidectomy. Coming to contraindications, serviceable hearing ear, if it is a serviceable hearing ear where we hearing preservation is desired, in these cases, instead of performing radical mastoidectomy, we will be performing modified radical mastoidectomy when we are trying to preserve the hearing mechanism. Second, if the patient is medically unfit, in these cases also, we'll not be performing a radical mastoidectomy. So that's all about the contraindications of radical mastoidectomy. Now let's move on to discussing what is the anesthesia and positioning of the patient. Just like other surgeries, the anesthesia required is general anesthesia. And for positioning of the patient lies supine with their face turned to the other side, and the yurt which is operated is directed upwards towards the surgeon. Next, we'll do preparation of the patient. This involves the tragus and the postauricular skin being injected with 1% lignocaine with 1 in 1 lakh adrenaline to provide hemostasis and local anesthesia. The external auditory canal and tympanic membrane are examined, irrigated with saline and cleaned of any debris. And the canal wall skin is injected with 1% lignocaine and adrenaline in the posterior, inferior and superior quadrants. This helps in raising the flap very easily. So now moving on to discussing the procedure. So our steps are going to be very similar to modified radical mastoidectomy till a certain point. Let's discuss that in brief details. So first of all, an incision is a Weyl's post-auricular incision that we give over here. So we give an incision 1 centimeter behind and parallel to the retroauricular sulcus, starting at the attachment, the highest attachment of the pinna, and continuing till the mastoid tip. That is our incision over here. But we need to remember here that we should not give the incision at the sulcus, because that will present to you with two problems. First of all, closure of the wound will be difficult for you. And secondly, the sulcus, the retroauricular sulcus, will start to deepen as the scar starts to heal. So that's why we should prevent giving an incision right at the level of sulcus, but rather give it 1 centimeter behind and parallel to the sulcus. And second thing to remember here, it is important to remember, is that children, in young children, usually the mastoid, which lies over here, is not fully developed. So what happens is, we know that the facial nerve exists through the stylomastoid foramen. So if the mastoid is not fully developed, in that case, the facial nerve may lie more superficially, therefore being more prone to injury while you're giving the incision. So what do we modify here? Instead of giving the incision like we discussed just now, in cases of children, the posterior end of the incision is actually, the lower end of the incision is actually directed more posteriorly, so as to avoid the mastoid tip area. So that will avoid any kind of injury to the facial nerve. So now that we have given the incision, we deepen the incision through the soft tissue to reach the periosteum. Our next step over here is to expose the mastoid. So we'll have to give periosteal T-shaped incision. So what is this incision over here? So the first incision is a horizontal incision along the linea temporalis. And the second incision is a vertical periosteal incision, which is perpendicular to the first incision and continuing up to the mastoid tip. Now, as we have given this periosteal incision, our next step would be to take a Lempert's periosteal elevator and elevate all of this periosteum to expose the mastoid. So this will the periosteum will be elevated superiorly till over the tegmen, posteriorly over the sigmoid sinus, and anteriorly to the level of external auditory canal. Once you have exposed the periosteum, we'll be placing 2 self-retaining mastoid retractors so as to expose the complete mastoid cortex. So now that we have done this, our next step would be to identify the mastoid antrum. So our mastoid antrum is identified the surface landmark, which is the supramietal triangle or the McEwen's triangle. I have spoken about the boundaries of this in a previous video where I've discussed about canal wall up and canal wall down procedures. I've discussed the anatomical landmarks that you need to know in cases of mastoidectomy. So you can check it out for more details. So as we discover the McEwen's triangle, the surface anatomy to remember here is the antrum. It lies about 12 to 15 millimeter deep to this triangle. So we'll start to drill in this area and remove the mastoid cortex, and we'll be trying to reach the mastoid antrum. Second important thing to remember is a structure which is known as the corner septum. A corner septum is a septum which basically separates the squamosal cells from the petrosal cells, and it can actually be something that can misguide you into believing that you have reached the antrum, but you may have just reached the corner septum. So if you do not identify the corner septum and drill through this corner septum, you would actually not be able to reach the antrum, and then some residual disease may remain in the patient. So once we have drilled through the corner septum, we reach our antrum. Now, as we reach our antrum, we start to remove all the mastoid air cells, any disease process that we find over here. So we start to drill through all of them. Next step would be aticotomy. Even here, we are still at the same, we are performing the same steps as we do in a case of modified radical mastoidectomy. So in aticotomy, we in the same region, let's look at the first image over here. This image over here, in the first image, you can see that the bone is removed in a triangular area which lies above and behind the meatus. So superiorly along the suprameatal crest and inferiorly the line along posterior superior meatal wall. And the apex will be pointed towards zygoma. We start to drill the bone in this area so as to reach the attic. So bone removal is kept on carrying forward, and we reach into the additus and the attic, and our purpose is to expose the body in the short process of incus, and as we further go anteriorly, the incudomalleolar joint and the head of malleolus is also seen. The anterior limit of this would be the junction of the anterior meatal wall and the tegmen. So if we look at the image over here, the anterior meatal wall and the tegmen, this would be our anterior limit of performing aticotomy. So once we have performed aticotomy, our next step is to preserve the canal skin. This is done by elevating the posterior and superior canal skin along with the posterior annulus, and we reflect it anteriorly so as to prevent any injury from the burrs. So this flap that we have formed over here, it's a pedicled flap. This pedicled flap can be used later to cover the raw bone. So now that we have done this step, now we'll move on to the step so as to remove the posterior meatal wall. So the first structure that we'll be removing is the facial bridge. What is facial bridge? Facial bridge is that part of the bony canal, posterior canal wall, which is overlying the fossa incudis, and it bridges across the notch of Rivenus. So we remove the facial bridge. Then we remove the anterior buttress. Anterior buttress is where the posterior canal wall, if you see it, the image over here, this is the posterior wall, medial wall, anterior wall, superior wall, and inferior wall. So the part where the posterior bony canal is meeting the tegmen, this is the anterior buttress. So we drill down the anterior buttress as well. Next is to drill down the posterior buttress. So posterior buttress is the part of the bony canal which is posterior bony canal meeting the floor of the ESE, and this lies lateral to the facial nerve. So we'll remove the posterior buttress as well. So we have removed the facial bridge, the anterior buttress, and the posterior buttress. The reason for removing the posterior buttress is, so we can see this is the floor of the ESE and this is the mastoid floor going into the mastoid tip. So if we remove this posterior buttress over here, our purpose is to basically smoothen out and make the floor of the external auditory canal slope off gently into the mastoid tip. If we do not remove this, it can actually end up in developing a deep blind pocket at the level of mastoid tip, which can lead to more collection of discharge and more collection of residual debris. So this is the reason why we remove the posterior buttress. Next, our step here, after removing the posterior buttress, is to lower the facial ridge. Now, what is facial ridge? You can see here in the image, this is a facial nerve in the posterior wall of the middle ear. So facial ridge is this part of this posterior bony canal, which is covering the vertical segment of the facial nerve. This is our facial ridge. So what we have to do is we have to slowly lower down this ridge so that all the bone which is present lateral to the facial nerve between the tegmen and the floor of ESE is removed. Once you complete this process, our process which is to break down the bony canal wall, the posterior bony canal wall, to remove the posterior bony canal wall has been accomplished. So this is our step till which we have completely the same as modified radical mastoidectomy. So once we have lowered the facial ridge, it exposes the upper part of the facial recess and it fully exposes the pyramid, stapes, and cauda tympani. Now we'll remove all the disease that we see over here, any cholesteatoma sac, debris, etc., from the attic, additus, antrum, mesotympanum, hypotympanum, sinus tympani, facial recess, and we'll carefully clear around the oval window and round window niche area. Till this moment, is what we have discussed in modified radical mastoidectomy. Now, the steps will change for radical mastoidectomy. Important step to remember here is, now we have to remove the middle ear contents. Now, what does this involve? First is, the incudostepidial joint is separated. The tensor tympani muscle is cut just medial to the malleus. Next, the cochleariform process is fractured and removed. Then we mobilize the ossicular chain from the attic and remove all of it. But important to remember here is we retain the stapes foot plate and if possible along with the superstructure. But malleus and incus are definitely removed over here. Then the tympanic membrane along with the annulus and all the mucoperiosteal lining of the cavity, these are also removed. Next, the ESE and the floor of the hypotympanum, they are made to be level with each other by removing the inferior bony annulus. Lastly, we know that this is our eustachian tube opening. So in radical mastoidectomy, we close this eustachian tube with the help of a muscle or a cartilage. And why do we do this? This is to prevent any future ingrowth of mucosa into the middle ear space. So this is what is different in radical mastoidectomy. We remove all of these structures. We retain the stapes foot plate or the stapes suprastructure if possible. And we remove all of the tympanic membrane, annulus, mucoperiosteal lining. And we close down the eustachian tube opening. Now, at next would be to saucerize the mastoid bowl. The mastoid cavity that has now formed has to be smoothened out so that there is no sharp edges remaining. We need a smooth cavity because the smooth cavity will help in faster epithelialization of post-operative mastoid cavity. Once it has been saucerized, we'll irrigate it with saline to remove any particles and then we'll perform a meatoplasty where we try to widen the external auditory canal for post-operative cavity access. This, we do meatoplasty to first of all have a full post-operative cavity access to be able to inspect the mastoid cavity easily. Second, it will also ensure ventilation and easy self-cleansing. After meatoplasty, we'll reposition on the skin flap and then if we see that the mastoid cavity is very large, in these cases, we obliterate it with temporalis muscle or other soft tissue. Then we pack the cavity with antibiotic-soaked ribbon gauze and then we close the post-auricular incision in two layers and lastly apply the mastoid dressing. So these are all the steps of radical mastoidectomy and I've told you at each step how it is different from modified radical mastoidectomy. Lastly, we'll discuss a little about the post-operative care in such cases. So the mastoid dressing that we have applied is usually removed after 24 to 48 hours and we'll replace the outer gauze and cotton and look for any signs of perichondritis or infection of the meatal pack. Next, at about 7 days, we'll remove all the stitches and the meatal pack is changed. And then from here onwards, we'll change the pack at weekly intervals or we can also leave the cavity completely unpacked with regular suction clearing till epithelialization is complete. For 7 days, we'll continue antibiotics as analgesics. And lastly, important is cavity care. Now, the cavity gets fully epithelialized in about 2 to 3 months. So, we have to do cavity care, but periodically checking every 4 to 6 months for the first year. And then from after first year, we can check annually once for removal of any debris or infection. If we see any granulation tissue, then we remove it or cauterize it so as to not delay the epithelialization process. That's all about the post-operative care. So this is all about radical mastoidectomy, what are indications, aims, contraindications, steps of surgery and post-operative care. If you have any further questions, please note them down in the comment section and I'll get back to you.